I'd like to welcome everybody to our first seminar for July, because we've missed the two because of the 4th of July holiday. So welcome back to everybody. I need to remind you that, as usual, this meeting is live streamed and archived on YouTube. So please be aware of that. We're very grateful to our two speakers from the EPA today. We're looking forward to hearing their presentations. As always, Tom Helicar and I are here to answer questions, improve things, take your suggestions. Jim Sluka, as usual, handles the web side of things and has good ideas. Activities coordination, Lorenzo is on the call as usual. Joel Vannon has joined us as helping on the activities coordination for the seminar series. We've seen this slide many, many times. Please do help us build our web presence. We have a Slack channel that's not used so much. We have the Twitter MSM Viral. We have the IMAG MSM Wiki page, which is used quite a bit. Please help us keep it up to date. We have a LinkedIn page, which people are free to use. And we have our YouTube channel with our archive of talks, which we probably could use better. Again, we have the Twitter account, MSM Viral. If you use that tag, it'll help people find things related to this project. Are there any announcements that people would like to make before we move on to the seminars? We have the usual digital twin subgroup at 11 a.m. EDT tomorrow morning. If anybody thinks they should have been invited and weren't, please let us know. And then next week, we'll have the steering committee meeting. We have the Google form to suggest speakers. Please use that. We would really appreciate your help filling up our seminar schedule. As always, you've heard me say it before, suggest yourself, suggest your students, suggest your postdocs, suggest your friends, suggest the people that you'd like to hear from. Think broadly. They could be journalists, they could be experimentalists, they could be clinical, they could be corporate. Don't have to be modelers. Anything related to multi-scale modeling, which could be connected to immune prediction and response, is great. We do have two announcements. There is this great paper that came out in Frontiers in Physiology by group members and some additional people. Chantal and Yi and Michael and others on aerosol transport modeling. We're very pleased that that was successful. And we want to call people's attention to this NIH RFA on multi-omics approaches to immune responses in HIV vaccination and intervention. That seems to be a reasonably bioinformatics-y call. But there definitely is place for modeling as well, potentially in that kind of call. So are there any other announcements that people would like to make before we move forward? Upcoming schedules. Next week, we have Nate Jacobs from flashpub.io. July 28th, we have Sirkot Kola, talking about the European health data. August 4th, we have Patrick Kanunen talking about analysis of heterogeneous single cell kinase signaling dynamics. We still need speakers for the 11th going forward. We had thought we wouldn't have meetings in August because it's holiday for so many people, but in fact, several people have asked to speak in August. It's also possible for people to double up. So if somebody wants to speak during July or August on these same dates, that's fine too. Do help us, please keep the seminar series going and suggest people you'd like to hear. Okay, I don't want to take more time from our speakers. We'll begin with Tom Knudsen from the EPA talking about computational models of microglial cell dynamics during morphogenesis of brain microvasculature. And I'll turn over the share to you. You're muted, Tom.
How's that? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
That's great.
All right, I've got an echo, so I got to shut my sound down. Okay, well, thanks a lot for inviting us to present to the group. I've been working with James for maybe 10 to 12 years now on various projects for modeling. My angle is computational embryology and predictive toxicology. And what we thought we would do here would give you just a brief overview of our program in general, but then get into the specifics of the microglial work, and then pass it off to Caitlin, who is a student contractor that's been working with us for a few months. And she's been doing some nice work on modeling embryonic development. The disclaimer that we have is, of course, since we're EPA employees, these are opinions that are our own and don't reflect agency policy, so we're required to give you that information. The drivers of the work that we do is really coming from what's called new approach methods, or NAMs. And these can be described in two different recent roadmaps that have been produced by the FDA and by the EPA. So the FDA's predictive toxicology roadmap was created to identify the toxicology areas that could benefit from improved predictivity, as well as promising new technologies that could potentially meet these needs and support the replacement, reduction, and refinement of the use of animals in testing for pharmaceutical efficacy and safety. At the EPA, of course, we're interested in the regulation of environmental chemicals, and EPA published, this is from December of 21, its new approach methods work plan. And this was created to prioritize agency efforts and resources toward activities that aim to reduce the use of animal testing while continuing to protect human health and the environment. And the links that are provided there can take you to those roadmaps if you're interested in the details. So one of the things that we've been doing in my group is focused on building purpose-built in silico microsystems. And we've been using a cell agent-based approach where the cell is the autonomous decision-making agent in the model. And working in a shared environment, the interactions between cells can be realized. We had a conference a few years back where this really cool little model from Tim Otter was shown, where it's a self-regulating embryo. There's 21 cells that started, and you saw a shark bite take a group of cells out. The cells are recompeting. And what they were doing is using evolutionary approaches to try to identify the conditions that are required for cells to interact with each other, the formal rules that would restore the original number of cells. So they were a group that was originally working with the Virtual Soldier Project, and they sort of took some of their approaches and applied them to biological context. And this was a nice little publication on what they called anatomical homeostasis in a self-regulating virtual embryo. And as you may know, morphogenesis is a complex process, and it's what causes different tissues to develop their shape from a genetic blueprint and from self-regulation of interacting cells. Cells are organized in space and time, and they undergo the process of autopoiesis, or self-organization, based on rules that they get from the genetics and from the environment. And of importance here is that the things that influence cell fate decisions, both in vivo and in silico, are genetic factors and environmental factors that work together. We want to model the mechanisms by which these types of interactions are executed in vivo. We know that biomechanical forces are critical. They're not always well studied at the cellular level since we tend to be genome-centric, but we want to build in the biochemical interactions at a cellular level and look for the critical parameters that control multicellular coordination. And so looking at the cellulome as sort of a way of characterizing the network of cells that form an organ system, this is central for understanding the development of particular tissues and their roles in different disease processes. So our cell-based in silico models have been focused on predicting the effects of chemical exposure on embryonic development. And in the embryo, this is a series of coordinated multicellular behaviors that have to evolve into an anatomical structure over time and space. We have a lot of information on embryology and its normal pathways. And we also have a lot of data from our internal ToxCast program. And as we sort of look at the distributed pixelized data, what we're trying to do is figure out how the information comes together to form complex structures such as the embryo. With respect to birth defects, the cellular and molecular determinants of birth defects are very convoluted and they're difficult to unravel. So it's a clear process of complex biology, and birth defects in our country right now affect 3 to 4% of live-born babies. So we're thinking that the computational analysis of complex self-organizing systems from unidimensional data remains a challenge for predictive biology, both developmental health and disease. And that's what we're trying to solve with some of our models. And the cellular agent-based modeling approach, as you're probably familiar with, is one of the ways that this could be done in a very pragmatic way, building nature-inspired models where the cells are the agents and the rules are their interactions as we understand them. And we set those into motion as self-organizing systems. And we've been using the Glazier open source modeling environment, CompuCell 3D. I'm a big fan of that software. And many of my students and postdocs have been as well. The thing that we like about this approach, and it may not be so well appreciated with CompuCell 3D, is that it's a computationally intelligent system. It uses really soft computing or fuzzy logic that can simulate forces or properties governing cell activity where the rules are inexact or our knowledge is incomplete. One of the things, of course, is you figure you can never know as much as you need to know to make these simulations happen, but the computer has enough intelligence within this software framework that when you provide enough enabling biology, the self-organizing properties can actually begin to recapitulate biological processes, as you're well aware of. But the thing we like about it is that they can change course in response to particular stimulus, such as a genetic error or an environmental effect that's fed into the model from real-world data. So we can use these models to begin to unravel mechanistic causation of complex biology. And what we've been able to show is actually you get a good probabilistic rendering of where, when, and how a particular condition or combination of lesions might lead to an adverse developmental outcome. So we produce these models in silico, which we call cybermorphs. We've been working on this for a few years, but we've learned across looking at multiple systems is that this type of computational modeling, if you have sufficient biology, can allow you to quantitatively simulate the multi-scale dynamics of what happens when you perturb a system at the cellular and molecular level to predict an adverse phenotype. We call this project a virtual embryo. James Glazier had funding a few years back with us. They developed somite models, but you can see a number of the models that we've developed. Many have been already published. Some of the things we're working on, and the yellow ones are things that we would like to see from a future perspective. So rather than talking about things we've already published, in view of the goals of the IDT, the Immunological Digital Twin Project, and the fact that we're not immunologists, but would like to participate and get involved in collaborations, what I thought we would do is we just finish planning out the work that we're proposing to do for the next 4 years at the EPA, in my group at least. And that involves computational modeling of microglial cell dynamics during morphogenesis of the brain microvasculature. So I'm going to give you sort of a preliminary look at what we're doing. This is very preliminary. Some of the work's unpublished. We're trying to get a paper out on this before the fall, but the work is still in progress, and we certainly appreciate feedback or any interest in collaborations. As I said, I'm not an immunologist, but the microglial cell, as you probably are aware, is a hot topic in immunology these days. So what we focus on is what's called a neurovascular unit, which is a conceptual model. And the blood-brain barrier itself is embedded in the neurovascular unit. So this could really be considered the unit of the brain in terms of its neuronal compartment and its vascular compartment and how these compartments interact, which is obviously a very important problem for understanding how drugs and chemicals gain access either appropriately or inappropriately to the brain and cause potential effects on neurodevelopment. The four main cell types in the blood-brain barrier are endothelial cells, which are joined by continuous tight junctions. They're unique that they don't have typical fenestrations, and there's very limited capacity for transcytosis unless the endothelial cells are damaged. Parasites interact very closely with the endothelial cells. They're invested in the common basement membrane. And so the parasites turn out to be a very important part of the permeability of the blood-brain barrier. Astrocytes have their end-feed processes that connect directly to the basement membrane of the vasculature. And these cell types are supportive cells for the brain, but they typically appear after formation of the blood-brain barrier in development. Microglia, as you may know, are resident macrophages of the brain. They turn out to be named glia because they're very much glia in their appearance, but they're of hematopoietic origin, and they actually come from early embryonic development in the blood islands in the yolk sac. A couple of years ago, we did a general review on blood-brain barrier evolution and development. On the left, Kate Siley, a postdoc at the time, did a really thorough literature review on looking at the genes that are important for blood-brain barrier development and identified at least 86 that have some curated role. And they're portrayed here going from the evolutionary origin of the blood-brain barrier, or I should say neurovascular barrier, all the way from octopus and the first glial endothelial interaction that evolved up through even invertebrates into advanced vertebrates. And you can see across those 86 genes, just looking at their sequence homologies, how those genes evolved. We could classify them in different groups of function and cluster them together based on patterns of similarity of sequence information. And then what we did was we took that set of genes, and we looked how they map to the different cell types of the blood-brain barrier. And that's shown on the right, along with some of the molecular interactions that occur between those cell types. And we have in our in our disposal a lot of in vitro data. We've got millions of dose response studies from in vitro assays, over 1,000 different in vitro assays looking at different biological processes in the ToxCast chemicals dashboard system. And in yellow are highlighted just some of the different targets in this system where we have some in vitro data, where we've looked at anywhere up from 2,000 or more chemicals to those effects on in vitro processes. And so we have a way of mapping not only the biology to this system, but the toxicology that could be predicted from simple in vitro assays into a complex in vivo model. So So why the blood-brain barrier? Well, there is clear evidence from a variety of angles that pathophysiology of the blood-brain barrier is associated with dysfunctions in a number of different prenatal and antenatal conditions. So for example, neurodevelopmental defects such as Rett syndrome, autism spectrum, defective transport of hormones such as leptin in pediatric obesities, reduced brain insulin in barrier dysfunction during pregnancy, barrier receptor dysfunction during pregnancy, microglial activation and neuroinflammation such as what you might see in the Zika microcephaly episode that we had in, a couple of years back, or in fetal inflammatory response syndromes. GLUT1 transporter deficiency has been associated with epilepsy and learning disabilities, LAT1 dysfunction with autism, MCT8 deficiency with altered thyroid hormone delivery to the brain, which can lead to neurological impairment. And chemicals such as bisphenol A, lead, different pesticides, and retinoic acid can have effects on blood-brain barrier function during development. So while we know that chemicals of interest may interact with the blood-brain barrier, the question really is to what extent do they perturb the microvasculature that arises from brain angiogenesis during development? And our hypothesis is that microglial sensing is a key target for chemical effects on neurodevelopment through perturbation of blood-brain barrier formation and physiology. So the origins of microglia, as I mentioned earlier, are hematopoietic. So off to the upper left is the day and a half mouse embryo. And Florent Ginhau's lab discovered back in 2010 that the microglia lineage arises from blood islands that form in the early embryo. These are the initial blood islands that give rise to the hematopoietic lineage of the individual. And they're shown in the blue reporter. Those cells then migrate through the embryo, through its primitive vasculature as the vasculature is developing. The head is off to the left here. There's the heart, there's the head, there's the tail of a mouse. And these cells migrate by amoeboid movement through the early embryo and they reach the developing brain. And you can see here, they are peppered within the substance of the developing brain. And they actually creep along the neural tube as the neural tube is developing. And at specific sites, they're recruited into the brain itself where they function to regulate initially angiogenic invasion and later neurogenic interactions and differentiation. And this process occurs in mouse over the period from gastrulation up through fetal and postnatal development, where they have different consequences of function. The diagram down below shows those blood islands from the yolk sac and how the cells emigrate into the brain. And Florent Ginhau's group developed a model where they inject a critical receptor antibody into the pregnant mouse at day 6.5 and 7.5, so anti-CSF1 antibodies. When they do that, they knock out 95 to 99% of the microglial cells, not shown here in the lower right. So what are the consequences of that depletion? We've had a collaboration with them. They've worked at the Singapore Immunology Network, SIGIN, and they looked at vascular development in the absence of microglial cells in these mice, looking beyond formation of the brain. So these are fly-through sections. In red is the vasculature, and in green are fluorescent dextrans that are injected into the heart of the individual. And what they find, of course, as you would imagine, is when they use a 70K dextran, that's going to be confined to the vasculature. So there's a good overlap between the green and the red markers. When you look at the depleted system, the distribution of the microvasculature of the developing brain, as well as there's no green. You see the green outside, but it's not inside the brain. It's leaking. So this 3 kilodalton dextran itself is still a little bit leaky in a normal situation at, say, day 14 and a half. But in the absence of microglia, you actually see it in these lymphatic vessels that are. So what's happening is the dye is getting through the developing microvasculature and into the lymphatics and then being drained. So it's pretty clear that there's a reduction not only in the extent of microvascular development, but its function. So the red is the distribution of capillaries in the microvasculature and the green is the dye. And you could see in both cases that at the same time in development, there's quite a difference in the progression of microvascular development and function. So this tells us that microglial cells, which are known to be essential building blocks of neurodevelopment, but they're also essential building blocks of microvascular development of the brain for both angiogenesis and permeability. There've been a number of recent studies with single cell RNA profiling on microglial cells, which have developed a microglial cell atlas of the brain. And the interesting thing, it's shown off to the right, is that there's quite a bit of phenotypic diversity in the states of microglial cells in early development. And the diagrams off to the left show the difference between morphologies of resting microglial cells or homeostatic states, which are highly ramified. Those processes interact with different branches of blood vessels and neurons. But as the cells are activated by different cues, they become rounded and more amoeboid, and they migrate to places of injury or stress. So looking at the graph from the Masuda paper off to the right, they've mapped out the molecular heterogeneity of microglial cells at different life stages in a mouse. And what they find is, again, the cellular heterogeneity is very high in early stages of development. It declines towards birth, towards juvenile development, and into the adult, where it's fairly consistent, unless there are neuroinflammatory signals that may invoke disease processes, in which case they become more phenotypically diverse again. So what we need to keep in mind is that the gestational functions of the blood-brain barrier occur soon after the structure emerges in development, which is a concept that's not really well appreciated. Although it may not be fully mature until birth, but in humans, we're talking about this occurring before the 8th week of development, when many women may not even know they're pregnant, and pregnancy is just being established clinically. So we believe that the heterogeneous interactions between endothelial cells, pericytes, and microglial cells are a good opportunity for modeling this complexity and understanding some of the potential roles that are being played. And so the goals we've set forward for our next 4 years are to try to develop a fully computable system for in silico modeling and simulation that can titrate the chemical effects from our different in vitro bioactivity profiles in ToxCast, and then map these effects to critical windows of neurovascular development in real time. So looking at things such as the modeling the microglial origins and immigration in the early embryo that lead to colonization of the neural tube and its subsequent vascularization, building a computational neurovascular unit, which we call CNVU, that implements microglial sensing and the molecular heterogeneity of the microglial pool as described in the single cell microglial cell atlas of the brain. And what I won't talk much about today is then building interactive cinematic scientific visualization models that bring this type of biology into really a public eye, where you have striking cinematic movies that that show what's happening at the cellular level, much like you see with these amazing movies on planetary discovery. So here's the control network that we're starting with, looking at different cell types. I won't go into the details here, but it's got complexity. We've got some models I'm not going to show today where we started incorporating neurons, but we've been focusing on the microglial endothelial interactions in the brain. And so Om Nafade has been working on modeling this process, and he's developed a CompuCell simulation where, in this case, the perineural vascular plexus that invades the neural epithelium sends in vascular branches, and they interact with microglial cells that are present throughout the tissue of the neural epithelium. And when he takes the microglial cells out, you can see the morphology that forms. It doesn't stop the invasion of the vascular branches, but you see that the tortuosity, the branching, the endothelial connectivity is much reduced. And actually, that is the phenotype that's observed in microglial deficient systems in the mouse retina and other regions of the brain. So he's able to do imaging on these analyses, look at different parameter effects. So sensitivity analysis to ask the question in the model, what's the optimal number of microglial cells? What's the optimal density of perineural vascular branches to invade the structure? And what are the optimal conditions of the different growth factors that drive these processes, such as VEGF-A, VEGF-C, CSF1, and other things we're looking at? And so he can begin to quantitate these types of effects in the model. And we can now take that model and we can go back to our ToxCas chemicals dashboard for different compounds. As I said, we've got information from thousands of chemicals over 1,000 different assays. And we asked the question, can we find chemicals that affect all three of the signals that are driving this simulation? And mancozeb is one of them. That's a pesticide. And here is the in vitro profile of mancozeb against those three assays. You can see CSF1 is inhibited first, then FGF receptor 3 response to VEGF-C, and FGF receptor 2 response to VEGF-A. And we can incorporate the parameters changes into our model that show a predictive effect of what might happen at these different concentrations of exposure based on the in vitro data. And then plot out the emergent effects of that exposure. And one of the key things here is that as the blood-brain barrier is forming at this interface, this is the neuroprogenitor growth zone of the brain. This is the area of the brain that gives rise to the brain mass in the fetus. And so the vascularization is very important. If you don't have that vascularization of this neurogenic niche, you're going to have problems in fetal brain development. And so the quantitative dynamics predicted here with mancozeb suggested an effect at about 0.5 micromolar would be significant. Ohm has worked on a number of different chemical case studies looking at different replicates with different compounds, mancozeb and others, and has found that across the space we've looked at so far, two chemicals had significant effects predicted by the model on vascular responses. So one of our collaborators at University of Wisconsin is William Murphy's group. They're a bioengineering group that's actually developed with funding from the EPA, a model looking at human neurovascular development in a medium three throughput type bioengineered system. So their model looks at perineurovascular invasion of a human neuroprogenitor layer, and it incorporates a microglial cell type. And they can measure a number of different things. And so they tested for us mancozeb as well as tetracycline, but mancozeb is something they published on. And they predicted or they observed an effect in their culture model of mancozeb at 0.3 micromolar. So our model predicted a 0.5 micromolar effect, and their model showed a 0.3 micromolar effect. So with this type of a simulation, you know, we've got some of the basic components of the model that looks biologically interpretable. Of course, we want to build it into 3D systems since biology occurs in three dimensions. And we want to bring in the different compartments of the neurovascular unit. So we've got some information on the vasculature and the early neural epithelium, but we want to bring in neural differentiation. The different cell types are shown. Little red stars are things that we've currently got incorporated. Things that are not starred are things that we really haven't incorporated yet. But you can see there's a number of signals that are critical for microglial development that are not yet incorporated into the model. There's a number of important transduction pathways that we have a lot of toxic gas chemicals that could potentially disrupt. We've got things such as barriergenesis. We want to bring in vascular flow, shear forces, the different molecular transporters and adhesion molecules that seal the blood-brain barrier. We want to look at emergent properties such as the vascularization of the subventricular zone, which is the neuroprogenitor niche. We want to eventually look at neural networks and brain mass formation as a predictive model of neurodevelopmental defects of the brain. And a number of case studies shown to the lower right. Some of them we've already gotten a start on, and there's others that we want to work with. So that's my little mini talk. And a number of the folks that have been working with us on this project. And now I'm going to pass it off to Caitlin. And Caitlin, I guess, can you share without me stopping sharing?
Let me see.
So while you're doing that, Caitlin is she's an ORAU student services contractor that's been working with us for maybe half a year or so. She just graduated from the University of North Carolina with an undergraduate degree in neurobiology and mathematics. And she wanted to gain some experience in research. And so we were fortunate to be able to recruit her, and she'll be working with us. She's worked on a really cool model that I'll let her talk about. But then she gets into working with our microvascular system as well. So Caitlin, take it away. I'll see if I need to do anything.
Thank you. Yes, if you could unshare your screen, I'll be able to pull up my slides. Okay, can everyone hear me and see my slides?
You're good.
Take it away.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. All right, so hi everyone. As Tom said, I'm Caitlin Barham, and I'm an ORAU student contractor working with him on one of our models. And once again, since we are with the EPA, I wanted to let you know these views are completely mine and don't reflect any agency policy. And so my work so far has focused on computationally modeling cell fate specification within a 3D synthetic gastruloid simulator. So to give some context of the developmental biology behind this model, gastrulation marks a critical period in embryonic development where the body plan is decoded during early embryogenesis. In the mouse, this happens in the first week of development. For humans, it's in week 3. And the main feature of this time is the formation of the primitive streak, which is a line across the midline of the embryo through which pluripotent epiblast cells migrate and then differentiate into the primary germ layers of the body. And so looking at this first image on top, this is a human epiblast from the Kyoto collection. And you can see the formation of that primitive streak more towards the posterior side on the midline of this embryo. Whereas on the bottom image, you can actually see the ingression of these epiblast cells and then their differentiation into mesodermal cell types and migration out to their final sulfate positions. And so computationally modeling this process allows us to represent gastrulation across both space and time. And a control network of intertwined morphogenetic signals, such as fibroblast growth factor signaling, as well as bone morphogenetic protein, Hox genes, and so on, can be perturbed with genetic or environmental consequences to be used for predictive biology. So the first step in designing this project was putting together this workflow. We knew that our problem was to model gastrulation with it being such an integral period of early development. So we started with literature mining using the abstract sifter, which is a powerful tool developed by Nancy Baker, a contractor at Leidos with the EPA, that mines the PubMed database for information based on self-defined queries. And then based on that, we were able to get an understanding from the literature on the important signals at play and regulation apparent during this process. And we took all that and were able to design a control network within Cell Designer. Next was learning the CompuCell 3D framework. This was my first time working with any kind of virtual tissue or computational modeling. So using the plentiful online manuals and videos in order to get acquainted with the system before deciding on our input parameters, such as cell types and which protein gradients would be included in the system, allowed us to render our first synthetic epiblast prototype. Through which we were able to get multi-scale simulations so we could analyze our output parameters such as cell counts and multi-scale visualizations that we've been able to pull from it. We've now started some sensitivity analyses by perturbating some of the important morphogenetic signals in our control network so that we can validate our outputs or these cybermorphs that we've developed showing adverse developmental outcomes. With our next steps being to operationalize this model using chemical stressors found in the ToxCast database that Tom talked about so that we can quantitatively predict chemical effects with this model. So the key signaling factors that we've input into this model, looking at the left, state two, we're really focused on this primed pluripotency for the early gastrulation. Our model is dealing with embryonic days 5.5 to 6.5 in the mouse. And we're modeling the mouse epiblast because there's, of course, so much more literature and information on mouse development. But we know that all of these signals, all of these important patterns are also conserved in the human. So our model is very human relevant for translating this information. And so we see that our key factors that we're focused on are FGF4, BMP4, WNT3, nodal, and the lefty and Cerberus one, which I'll get more into on the next slide. So this is the control network that we started building on Cell Designer. And so when our model starts, the embryo is just a flat bilayer. On the top, we have the epiblast, and on the bottom, we have the visceral endoderm or hypoblast. And so this all starts with the secretion of fibroblast growth factor 4 signaling from the hypoblast, which maintains BMP4 expression from the posterior visceral endoderm. A gradient of BMP4 being higher in the posterior embryo allows for WNT3 secretion, which further cascades to allow for nodal secretion. And the most important thing for anterior-posterior polarity and patterning is this nodal gradient, which is maintained by the lefty one and Cerberus one mediated inhibition of nodal's action in the anterior epiblast. So this was our main control network that we encoded into our model. And FGF4 and BMP4 are the first morphogenetic signals we decided to perturb with our model, which you will see some of later on. This is our working prototype of our synthetic gastruloid. On the left is our cell color map. And in this first video that's playing, we see that the blue epiblast cells are on top. They kind of hide the view because the epiblast is self-renewing, it's proliferating. So in a moment, the second video will start just with that epiblast layer peeled back. But so we have the epiblast on top with the visceral endoderm on the bottom. The green and orange are just marking anterior versus posterior polarity for you. And we see at the beginning the formation of the primitive streak right along the midline of the embryo right here. The epiblast cells migrate inward, differentiate into different mesodermal cell fates. From the most axial, we have cortomesoderm in pink, followed by periaxial in red and lateral plate in purple. And so as each of these epiblast cells differentiates after passing through the streak, they then migrate out to their destined cell position as encoded in the genome's body plan. And the most important thing for a very important concept in understanding gastrulation and how these epiblast progenitor cells are actually receiving their mesodermal cell fate types is the Hox clock. So homeobox or Hox genes confer a molecular address with spatial consequences upon progenitor cells based on temporal collinearity. So Hox genes are encoded in a specific sequence so that they are expressed temporally. If we look at this clock figure on the bottom, we see that the first Hox genes, we've got four included in our model, D4, D9, D11, and D13. And so the first Hox genes, D4, are expressed the earliest, and then once it's turned on, Hox D9 is later activated, followed by 11 and 13. So we see that there is a temporal progression of the Hox gene activation. And so as an epiblast cell passes through the primitive streak, its Hox address is locked in to specify mesodermal regional fate. So those first epiblast cells to migrate through the primitive streak will be tagged by only D4, followed by ones progressing a little later will be tagged by both D4 and D9. But it's this Hox address that specifies their fate, as well as the positional information as to where they'll migrate to after differentiating. And so we can see in the mouse gastruloid image above that the later expressed Hox genes also correspond with more posterior cell fates, with the D13 cells really being confined to the very posterior part of this mouse gastruloid. And so from this, we know that regional destiny of these internalized mesoderm fields are determined by both genomic and environmental factors. And the speed of this Hox clock, or the speed of the activation of these Hox genes, are dependent on CDX, which regulate collinear Hox gene expression according to anterior posterior positional information. So our main question was, what effects would we expect from interfering with CDX within our synthetic gastruloid? And this brings us to our first case study, which is where we first had to define our prediction for perturbating FGF4. So FGF4 is a determinant of CDX-dependent regulation of the Hox clock, where reduced levels of FGF4 slow temporal progression of the Hox gene activation. And progressive activation of CDX specifies the more posterior mesodermal cell fates by activating those last Hox genes. As we can see in this paper by Young et al., in panel B in the middle, we see that the mouse tail formation was not completed because the CDX genes were interfered with. So they weren't active in order to cause expression of those later posterior cell fate defining Hox genes. Whereas when that Hox gene was turned on, we see a rescue of the phenotype. So our hypothesis was that within our model, a reduction in FGF4 signaling should delay expression of the posterior Hox genes and reduce posterior mesoderm specification. And in our model, this is what we saw. So in these videos to the side, we're seeing the cells of the epiblast being marked by the expressed Hox gene of the time. So at the beginning, we see only blue cells. Those are those marked by Hox D4, followed by D9, D11, and D13 in the green, yellow, and red once they turn on. In the top, we see a normal run, whereas in the bottom, our FGF4 signaling is reduced by half. And so we can see that at the end of the model, in the bottom, we only really have those marked by Hox D4 and D9. Where the later activated and more posterior cell fate defining Hox D11 and D13 genes weren't activated in time to specify their cell fate on the epiblast cells. And so we can also see that in the graph to the side, we see an increase in the cells marked for D4 and D9 and a reduction down to zero for those labeled D11 and D13. Our second case study, we wanted to predict what would happen from perturbating BMP4. So we know from our control network that FGF4 maintains the expression of BMP4 from the posterior visceral endoderm. And in turn, this signal is what primes posterior cell fates within the mesoderm. In this Mira et al. Paper, we find that partial loss of function from BMP4 delays recruitment of the paraxial mesoderm-destined epiblast cells. So this causes an expansion of the paraxial mesoderm and the formation of supernumerary somites. So in this top row here, we can see the formation of additional columns of somites. And in our model, we hypothesize that a partial loss of BMP4 function should phenocopy this expanded paraxial mesoderm field, and we should see a reduction in the lateral plate mesoderm because of this. And with our model, this does phenocopy the aforementioned paper. As we're seeing these models run, the bottom shows the BMP4 reduction, and we're seeing that those red paraxial mesoderm cells are extending much farther laterally than in our normal simulation. And we see, in turn, a smaller lateral plate or a purple mesoderm because of this. And this is also shown on the graph as well. And we wanted to combine the both of these to see what would happen if we interfered with FGF4 and BMP4 signaling at the same time. So also from this Mira et al. Paper, we found that inhibition of FGF4 partially rescues the phenotype from the BMP4 deficiency. It restores the recruitment of paraxial mesoderm-destined cells at the correct time. As shown here on the bottom row of the panel, the SU5402 is an inhibitor of FGF4. So when it is when we have the inhibition of fibroblast growth factor as well as the inhibition of BMP4, we don't see the formation of additional columns of somites, but we do still see an expansion of the paraxial mesoderm. So in our model, a decrease in both FGF and BMP should slow the Hox clock to dampen the impact of BMP4 deficiency on the paraxial mesoderm. And here are our results of the concurrent reduction. So we still see the same slowing of the Hox clock. So we only truly see cells marked by both Hox D4 and D9 as we did with the FGF4 deficient phenotype. However, we see some rescue of the paraxial mesoderm recruitment. There are still some heightened levels of paraxial mesoderm and a little bit dampened in the lateral plate. However, it does not extend as far laterally as it does with just the BMP4 being reduced. And in summary, gastrulation is a critical period of development where our body plan is decoded from the genome into a 3D pattern that maps regional mesoderm fates. And the progression of this is dependent on the Hox clock, which is part of a broader control network of regulatory genes and proteins. So we've designed a working prototype using CompuCell 3D that forms a primitive streak, features cell migration, and the self-organization of regional mesoderm. And we've performed case studies simulating perturbations in this control network through FGF and BMP, and recovered human-relevant cybermorphs that phenocopy results found in experimental mouse embryology literature. Future applications of this model include quantitative modeling of chemical exposures using the ToxCast database to allow for the mechanistic prediction of toxicity. And for acknowledgments, of course, I work with Tom on this project. Richard Spencer has put a lot of work into this model as well, and Nancy Baker developed the abstract sifter we use for literature mining. And that is all. Thank you.
Okay, thank you to both of our speakers. The floor is open for questions. Navid, please.
Yes, thank you so much for the talks. They were great. I have a question for Tom. when you were talking about the the effect of the microglial expression on the tortuosity of the vasculature, I'm curious to know what is the medium in between made out of? Like, is it a solid kind of medium, or is just like, does it have like a fluid like behavior in between?
In silico, Navid?
Yes.
The milieu itself, right now it's just an abstraction of, at the time of development, the system is radioglia with lots of extracellular matrix.
And
that's fine. Okay. We haven't incorporated the radioglia or extracellular matrix yet into the model.
Oh, I see. So that was my second question. I wanted to know if like some kind of like, I don't know, mechanical parameters that can affect the, you know, tortuosity rather than like just the expression of microglial has been like a future plan for you or something actually valid or not.
Yeah, so this is driven, the model's driven by what's called microglial bridging or macrophage bridging, where the microglial cells sort of reach out and join two endothelial tip cells and bring them together. And so you get that tortuosity. Without that bridging, it doesn't impair the invasion of the vascular sprouts, but you don't get that branching. And that has actually been described in the retina of the CSF deficient OPOP mouse.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions? I was going to ask more of so Lorenzo, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you both for the seminars. They were really good. And I have a passion for vascular biology and I do it myself. I'm focusing on in vitro system to emulate some of the process of angiogenesis, etc. So, and I'm also looking at some modeling about that. So I'm really happy to see that so much has been done, of which I wasn't aware. And so I have a lot of technical questions. I will leave them perhaps for another time in a separate occasion. But a general one would be at this point, now that the morphogenic system is very well developed, I see in CompuCell, for example. So it's nice to see that you can create nice tubule-like structure, etc. What it should be the next step? Because, well, I'm focusing on sometimes on molecular networks and protein and gene regulatory networks, and the underlying system seems to be very complicated. Should we focus on that or try to simplify somehow? What is your feeling after your experience on this in this field?
Well, I'll go first, Lorenzo. That's sort of the million-dollar question. How complex should these models be? You know, James and I talk about this all the time. This should be as simple as possible, but not so simple that you don't need the in silico model. But I could tell you that, you know, there are other examples of in vitro models, particularly the system Caitlin's been studying. There are groups that have developed microphysiological models of the human gastruloid, where they've perturbed the same things that she's perturbed. In fact, that's what we were following along. I think the importance here is that computational models should work with experimental models. And the best way to do that, if you're modeling a human embryo, is to work with bioengineers that are building human relevant microphysiological systems, such as Bill Murphy's lab, Zhenpeng Fu's lab at University of Michigan, and other labs.
Thank you. I'm focusing actually on building microphysiological system for angiogenesis. That's why
great. I love that.
Thank you very much for the talk and for the answer. Thank you.
Yeah, of course. And just to add on to that, that's one of the main things I was running into when doing the literature search to define the control network and find what all should be included. Because Richard Spencer, before I got started on the project, he worked a lot on modeling the biology included here. And I was working on the literature search to find out how much gene regulation should we encode into this. And so it really is a difficult question to try to define a hard stop on. It's just finding what's most biologically relevant with other experiments going on right now, as Tom was saying, because without encoding in any kind of regulation, then we won't really be able to get the perturbations we're looking for predictive toxicology. So it's really just finding the most important ones, I would say, based on the period you're looking at and focusing on those first. And you can always go in and expand later on as new work comes out if the need arises.
It's all about defining the scope early on. Otherwise, you'll keep modeling away for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Yeah,
You're muted, Tom. Yep. Yeah, you're muted again.
I'm muted.
I see Jim Sluka on the line. Jim, you did some really nice modeling looking at liver vascular flow. And, you know, this is certainly something that needs to be brought into the fold in terms of understanding blood-brain barrier development and bringing in the permeability factors and the mathematics of transport. So we'd certainly be happy to hear any comments from you.
Well, right now I'm working on a project doing blood-brain barrier permeability, but in adults, not in a developmental system. So yes, blood flow is certainly going to confuse things, especially in an embryo where you don't necessarily have patent blood flow.
Well, and then, you know, in terms of the adult blood-brain barrier, of course, you know, there's a paper that just came out as a review today, I think, looking at pharmacological effects on the blood-brain barrier and microglia. And, you know, people are talking about drugs that can open the blood-brain barrier when need be through perhaps the microglia.
Yep. In both good and bad ways.
Right.
We had a talk a few months ago about using ultrasound to permeabilize the blood-brain barrier on a temporary basis. So that's a mechanical approach to doing it too.
Well, if you're a pregnant woman getting ultrasound, that might be a concern.
Well, in this case, it was the you have to focus the ultrasound, so you wind up with a somewhat different. It's not the imaging ultrasound. The intensity isn't high enough to do much. I'm sure it does a little bit, but not. Okay. Other questions, comments.
One comment that I have on the blood-brain barrier thing is that is probably if you look at 7.5, 8.5 in a mouse at the brain vasculature or head vasculature, and then you look 2-4 days after, they look very, very different. And that might be due to the glia or to all the other stuff that's going on in that time.
Lorenzo, the blood-brain barrier in a mouse appears day 9.5. And by day 14.5, we think it's fairly well functional based on the work we've seen. The pharmacology field has always felt that you don't have a mature blood-brain barrier until birth. Now, you know, I would agree that probably there are aspects of brain vascular remodeling that occur during later fetal stages. But I think the impact of that is also tied to neuronal circuitry formation. So if you talk, you know, you're thinking about, say, signals that mediate blood flow in the adult brain, well, they could be becoming active in the fetal brain as well.
Also, the guidance patterns between neurons and vascular cell are very much shared. So there is a lot of crossover there.
Yeah. But certainly an area, you know, for further collaboration, if it's something that folks are interested in, which is why I think James invited us to this forum.
Right. Well, people here are interested in multi-scale modeling of all kinds. And so I think it's very relevant. I think maybe coming back, Caitlin, to the things that you were showing, Tom also, but let's focus on you for a second, which is I worked for many years on primitive streak formation. And we never were able to do what you and Tom seem to be now be able to do very systematically, which is build these interaction networks. The data mining and your use of pathway designer then to build the interaction models. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about the workflow you actually go through. What are sort of the practical issues that you have to address to start constructing these rather complex signal and regulatory pathway models and putting them into a computable format?
Yeah, sure. So it's been a very much a trial and error process because I wasn't an expert with Python or coding or designing these kind of computational frameworks before I got here. I had a bit of experience from a class or two at UNC, but a lot of the learning I've done has been on the job and a lot of it through the CompuCell scripting manuals and books out there. But luckily, like when I had started, Richard Spencer had previously been working on the model and got a lot of the actual biology running. He had the actual shape, he had the primitive streak formation and the migration of the cell types happening already. So it was really my focus on getting this control network in. And so it's definitely been time consuming because we're trying to look at these proteins and figure out what exactly are the specific roles that each one is playing when they're all so interconnected. But it's, you know, a lot of the literature search and trying to find and verify, okay, this looks to be like what this is doing this early on in development, and finding the literature like the ones I showed showing what's happening if only this protein is messed with. And so it's a lot of looking for that, but then once you do, just introducing these consequences into the frameworks. And so it looks different based on whatever phenotype you're trying to copy. Like for the paraxial mesoderm expansion, what I've got going for it is I have at a certain time, or for each step, it's at a certain Monte Carlo step, I get the concentration at the fields of BMP. And if the concentration is below the threshold, then I have it so that the cells that have the fate type for the lateral plate mesoderm, if they're within a certain angle, they switch fate types to become the paraxial mesoderm. And so it's a lot of the trial and error, things like that, trying to find what's the simplest way to code it so that my model's actually going to run when I finish putting this piece in. But so for now, for me, for that part, it's just at a certain Monte Carlo step, it gets the BMP4 concentration. If it's below the threshold, it switches a certain subset of the lateral plate mesoderm. The epiblast cells destined to be lateral plate mesoderm, it rewrites their instructions and says, okay, when you pass through the streak, you're going to become paraxial instead. And so it's a lot of brainstorming, but especially when you've got, you know, other people talk through with it, like with Richard, where he's been more working on this model longer than I have. Just it's the collaboration that really helps figure these perturbations out.
I guess in that case, your connection of that cell designer set of pathways to actual computer implementation, you're inspired by it, but you're not actually solving the cell designer ODEs, or you're not building a specific explicit pathway model. I'm asking, for example, Tom Helicar has packages to do stochastic Boolean networks. Other people who sometimes come do other kinds of network modeling. And so the question about how do you assemble those networks from the literature, you mentioned using an abstract sifter, but that doesn't give you a network that you could put into cell design. So I think that process of building that regulatory network, I think is pretty intimidating. I have to say, for me, building the biophysical side of it is relatively easy. Figuring out what network to use for control is intimidating to me. And so when I see the group, you and Tom's group in general, put together these very elegant cell designer models of control, that to me I would love to learn how to do that, I guess. That's the way I'd put it.
I'm sure that there's better ways to do it. The way that I did it was pretty time intensive because it's just running the abstract sifter is a great tool for just going through the PubMed database. And like if I query for FGF4, like querying for certain things together when I'm trying to figure out one protein's effect on another gene's expression, it'll pull up all those abstracts for me to look through. But it's a lot of just searching the literature and trying to find a consensus, which can be hard to find on some of these things because there's not that much data out about the specificity yet. But just looking toward the literature, trying to find a consensus, and if there's not one, you've just got to try to piece it together in a way that makes sense with the basis of literature that's out there. I definitely don't know the most streamlined way to do that, but using the abstract sifter to get a general idea of the body of work out there on it is definitely what worked for me.
Yeah, so maybe we could invite you guys back to talk more about the abstract sifter because as James mentioned, our group does a lot of the construction of the mechanistic network models and be it the stochastic Boolean models for signal transduction and gene regulation or genome scale metabolism models. And there is a lot of manual curation and it takes a lot of time. We have not deployed any sort of automatic screening of the literature. We basically, it's a very laborious job where my poor students and postdocs, they just go into the literature and they start with a review article that shows you, you know, some of the major pathways that you're interested in. And then you start going down the rabbit hole and finding the evidence for individual interactions and so on and so forth. And so I personally, selfishly would love to hear more about the abstract sifter and you know, how sophisticated it is and what it can do or can do. I just looked at the paper. It looks like you guys published it in 2020, but would love to learn more about it.
So Tom, you know, people that use this abstract sifter come back to us and say, how did they ever survive without it? You know, this is people that are doing mostly multidimensional biology. If you're doing unidimensional biology, you can just use PubMed. But when you get into the complexity, you really need tools like this. And Nancy has a presentation she gives quite regularly on this as a tutorial. She'd be happy to present to this group, you know, at the next open date, James, if you let me know what that is. The only constraint would be if she goes on summer vacation, but.
So we have, that would be amazing, Tom. So we have August 11th through September 1st open, and then anything after September 15th. So whichever Thursday would work, that would be great.
Yeah, let me check for August 11th.
The sooner the better, because I think there are many, many of us who would benefit from this. This is why I was saying that serendipity is important, because there may be techniques that may not sound like you're doing specifically immunology, but the techniques that you mentioned in terms of multi-scale modeling and validation are the same ones that are needed in these other contexts.
Because yeah, I can attest that abstract sifter made a big difference for me, because before I officially got onboarded to start working at the project, I was trying to look through the literature to get a better idea of gastrulation, of what's controlling this. And again, you know, got stuck in that rabbit hole that most people do, trying to look through each referenced article. But getting started and her giving me the tutorial on how to use it, it makes a huge difference.
We're good at going down the rabbit hole now. We're very efficient.
Yeah. Well, you know, this is one of the things I like about CC3D is you can hide a lot of that rabbit hole complexity inside of a cell, because the cell is your decision-making entity. Mm-hmm.
Other questions? I always have them lined up, so in case there aren't, but I was going to ask, coming back to Tom, to the microglia. We've heard quite a few talks in the past half year about microglia, of course, in a different context, which is inflammation. And the flip direction is that some of the molecules that we think of in the embryological context show up also in inflammatory contexts. So TGF-beta and some VEGFs are released as part of the response to early viral infection, probably because they're permeabilizing the endothelial layer so that immune cells can get out of the vasculature into the infected tissue. But I was wondering, and this maybe isn't so much for the developmental process, although I'm sure there's inflammation also during development in some of these pathologies, which is, if you thought about, I noticed you had a couple of immune, one interleukin, IL-8 you had on your wish list. But I was wondering if you thought about more about the role of microglia in immune relaying and amplification of inflammatory signals. Whether that's even turned on in embryos, but potentially you could also be addressing adult toxicology, because one of the things that you certainly see when you begin is that the responses of tissues to infection and the responses of tissues to other kinds of damage aren't that different. You have AMPs, if it's bacteria or virus. You have DAMPs, if it's toxicological damage, but they're still mediated by toll-like receptors, nod-like receptors, and so the inflammatory response to that initial damage is not so different. So I know it's a philosophical question, but I guess I was trying to get a sense of whether you have any thoughts about ways of perhaps unifying some of these concepts through the study of inflammatory response.
Yeah, I think, James, the concept of fetal neuroinflammatory effects, I think, is where sort of the two fields come together. And, you know, with regards to the immunological digital twin approach, as I've indicated, you know, while you were preparing your sort of proposals, there's a lot of, I think, a lot of expectation that your adult immune system is going to have a developmental programming component. And, you know, as we learn more about developmental immunology, we're finding that, you know, various priority chemicals can have effects on the developing immune system. And what we don't really know is what's the long-term impact on that. So, you know, you're priming the system. We know there's several waves of microglia that can be recruited into the brain during fetal and neonatal development. And, you know, the cues that would do that could be very local cell injury, inflammatory responses. I think it's a great point. I don't know enough about the immune system to, you know, to project forward, but somebody like a colleague at East Carolina University, Jamie DeWitt, who I think you've invited to the IDT project, is an expert in that area. She may not know much about the modeling side or even the molecular biology, but she knows about development of the immune system.
Thank you. And I was really struck when we had this talk by Ben Tenover from NYU. And the idea that long COVID is potentially, at least partially and maybe primarily, a problem of overexcitation or improper excitation of microglia. And so the developmental questions aren't exactly the same, but once you have that nice model of your structural unit in the brain, that structural unit in the brain can then be extended to think about immune signaling, because you'll have the components there. And to me, that's a very exciting possible direction to go with the things that you're building.
Well, that's where, you know, your idea at Future Talks about a global alliance for modeling can really serve as a springboard for bringing folks in that don't consider themselves modelers, but we need their expertise.
Other questions? I see. I mean, Sharon, you're a developmental biologist. Do you have anything to?
Nothing specific, but I did enjoy these talks.
I guess I was very impressed with how much in the gastrulation simulation, the primitive streak development, how well you were able to get cell migration to work. It's not so easy actually to get cell migration that well. And to see that log range, that kind of log range directed cell migration working in 3D, to me was actually quite impressive. That's sort of a technical thing for people. I mean, if you don't use CompuCell, you wouldn't appreciate how hard that is to make it work. But one thing,
James, when she inherited the state of the model that Richard had worked on, the problem was that, you know, Richard did a great job with the migration, but the epiblast wasn't dividing. So every time the cell migrated, you lost part of the epiblast. And Caitlin actually went in and changed that. So the epiblast is replenishing itself as a pluripotent stem cell system should. And, you know, I thought it was pretty clever of her to sort of strip away that epiblast layer so you could see the mesoderm just sort of virtually migrating. It was pretty cool.
And what is the control? Is it a contact mediated cell cycle inhibition or something else? I noticed it, Tom, in your vascular model, you have a delta notch regulation of proliferation, which Lorenzo would like since he's a delta notch specialist. But I just wondered how cell cycle is regulated perhaps in both situations.
Yeah, so we have the it's pretty contact regulated, and we have it so that the cells closest to the primitive streak migrate down first so that we have less bumping into each other. And because that's also something I ran into was trying to get the epiblast replenishment in there, was as new epiblast cells are coming up, then the ones still trying to get to the streak are bumping into them and not able to migrate through as well. But I just decreased the contact energy for the new epiblast cells versus the old ones, the parent cells. And it allowed for a bit better migration around them down into it. But so it's pretty contact mediated in mine.
So we had just published a $4 million study looking at thousands of chemicals on human stem cell behavior and did some machine learning to try to pinpoint what the critical pathways are, James, at these early stages. And I think the FOXO pathway really merits a lot of attention here. And you know, that intersects with so many different aspects of pluripotency, of early differentiation, cell migration, cell proliferation. And it's a very important pathway that really hasn't been all that well studied, I think, in gastrulation stages. And that's where I would put my money right now in terms of what is really coordinating the dynamics of these systems. But it's just, that's a, you know, you're recording this, so it's just my disclaimer that it's a prediction.
Okay, great. Is there a last question for our speakers? No, I'd like to thank you both so much for coming and speaking to us today. We really appreciated it. And as I say, we'll look forward to having your colleague come back to talk about the abstract sifter and maybe having you come back and report on progress as this work develops.
So will Tom, will you send me an email and I can put Nancy in direct touch with you so you can coordinate with her?
Absolutely. That would be great.
She'd love to speak to the group. I could tell you that. She'd be real happy to.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you again. Right. With that, I'll call the meeting to a close and see some of you tomorrow and everyone else next week.
Hey, James, can you put me on the IDT invite?
Yes, absolutely.
Sure. Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Thank you all.